Ladies and gentlemen, the students learn over the world, we lit our roads to be seen and to see and to be seen. And the road illumination should guarantee that we have a high level of road safety. And this brings me to my first question. What is road safety? In preparation of this lecture, I looked for in the CIE lighting vocabulary, electronic international lighting vocabulary of the CIE, that's the body, the Society of Lighting Engineers and Scientists. And I was really surprised, no entry. And I checked further technical reports like the road lighting as an accident countermeasure, but no definition. I go through all technical reports and I couldn't find a definition for road safety. Only in the technical report 88 is mentioned, that's the guide for the light of road tunnels, that road safety depends on a large number of factors among which lighting is only one particular constituent. So I have to check in other literature. And here in a scientific book, I could find this definition. Within the context of traffic signs, road safety refers to the absence of injustifiable risk and danger when people or goods are changing their location, that means from A to B. Goods could be, for example, those which are transported by traffic instruments within the traffic infrastructure and traffic organization. That's a typical technical definition nobody can understand by the first reading. I have tried to make a conclusion and road safety should guarantee riskless and concurrent usage of traffic areas by different traffic participants. And this brings us to the technical report 88. The contribution of lighting is to enable the road user to perform his visual task by ensuring a sufficient visibility of objects. But what is a sufficient visibility of objects? Do you know it? Normally, the lighting engineers use the ratio of the of the contrast of an object. Here you can see an object on this road. And the threshold of this object. We know we can see this object and the pictures on our retina. We describe this contrast with the surrounding luminance, with the object luminance, and we can calculate it, the contrast for this object. And then we use the Blackwell data of a standard object for homogeneous background. And you see if it's brighter, then it's easier to detect this object. And in this case, we checked we have a contrast of 3 and a surrounding luminance of 0.04, roughly, candela per square meter. That means in this case, this object is visible. But if we move this object on this road, then you see here in this position, we have a high contrast. In this position, we have a very low contrast. We cannot see it. That means, what should we take for a contrast? Additionally, if we use different reflection degrees, you see the contrast is changing over a huge range over this road. And that's the reason that we normally not use the visibility as counter for quality. We use the luminance or illuminance for the description of the quality of our roads. But here you can see two photographs of a junction in Jena. They replaced the high pressure sodium proof LED retrofit lamps, and they had a huge discussion in the city about the bad lighting quality. And what you can see here is this junction, that's a four-lane road, and the luminance in this case is 0.25 candela per square meter. That's the junction. And if you imagine that you have oncoming cars here, you have glare sources. And in this situation, it is not possible to see a pedestrian also on the side. Yeah, and so, okay, we have luminance values, but in this case, I would say we have not a sufficient visibility. And another example is here, that's the city of Jena. Here you see this measuring point with 0.7 candela per square meter. That's okay, not so good, but it's okay. But in this situation, you have a very bright facade here. Perhaps you have oncoming cars with glare sources, and you have trucks of the tram here. And for a cyclist in this situation, I would say it's not a sufficient visibility in this case. What are the consequences of bad visibility? We analyzed the accidents in Berlin between 2002 and 2014, and we had 26,000 accidents in Berlin with participants of pedestrians and cyclists. And what we can see, we have an increasing of numbers of cyclists in the last 5 years. What are the reasons for the bad visibility? First, we overestimated our own visibility. We think we can see the car and the driver can see us, but that's wrong. We have, second, the stupid situation that if you ask a people who have caused the accident, he will say, "I haven't seen the accident victim." But on the other side, we have no objective method to say is it was visible or not. We have not an objective method. We ask the policeman, we use the subjective evaluation of him, but we have not a good method. And of course, we have a lot of low light levels in Berlin. My colleague mentioned it, Berlin is the darkest city, that's on the one side very nice, but on the other side, if we ask about visibility on a lot of situations, then we have two low light levels, and we have a too high speed. In the analysis of all the accidents, we can say, if you reduce the speed, then the light level, then you can use a lower light level. And in this case, the student, Sebastian Maus, had investigated 10 kilometers of roads with accidents, and he counters the accidents per million cars and kilometers, and the standard 13201 were fulfilled in this situation. There we had a ratio of 0.4 accidents per million cars per kilometer, and in these cases, the requirements were not fulfilled, and we had a ratio of accident rate of 1.8, and that's roughly 4.5 times more accidents. What can we do to solve it? First, we can reduce the maximum speed. In our analysis, we can show if you have, or if you check the roads with tempo 30 km per hour as maximum, and you control this by radar or mechanical barriers, we had no accidents with pedestrians and cyclists. Second one, you can increase the light levels, but not only some percent. you have to increase the light level of factor 2 to factor 10. In this situation, you see a road here, and this is the situation in this direction, and this is the situation in another direction. This here, for this, the road illumination were replaced 10 years before from the old one to sodium, high pressure sodium lamps. You have a much higher level, you have no parking cars, and you can see we had no accidents. It's the same road with the same traffic. You have no cars in another roads. So that means we need a much higher illumination level. And of course, you have to do on the infrastructure like parking cars. The third solution is using adaptive concepts. That's your job. We are here to discuss in the lectures after this, in the afternoon, tomorrow. And that's your job. The first thing is we can use visibility concepts. I mentioned the simple concept is not enough. But we have a lot of knowledge to characterize. We have a lot of criteria where we can use small target visibility, revealing power, area ratio, and so on and so on, if you go in the literature. We know a lot of input variables that we can describe. We have the techniques to describe this. Luminance camera systems, we have a little bit knowledge about the covariables. So I say today we have the technical possibilities to use such concepts. And I will present some study of us, of my PhD candidate Juri Steblau. We had used the uncertainty of vision. And we used as depending variables the visibility of foveal objects with a gray card, 20 times 20 centimeter, the reflection degree of 5, 25, and 50%. And the experiment was carried out on our LED Laufsteg. And as method, we used the number of invisible objects. Here you can see the luminance picture as a false color with four different lighting distributions. Here in this luminaire we have four different lighting distributions, and the participants sit in a tent and had to look on this road, and for 0.2 seconds they had the possibility to check, can you see an object there or not? So that's in the tent, here that's the glass, the semi-transparent glass. And with this results, we could calculate the visibility rate or invisibility rate of this real different objects. Parallel, we checked different methods for the calculation of this. The basic idea of our favorite method is the revealing power method. Henschel had used it in 1967. You see, it's a long time ago. That's not completely new. We had adapted this method with some new aspects. And the basic idea is if you have here in this position, you can calculate the contrast for every position. And you can calculate the contrast for every reflection degree of such an object. That means here you see the visibility level as the ratio of contrast to the threshold contrast for every position and for every reflection degree. The threshold, we had used the Blackwell data for homogeneous value. The important or the difference to other methods is that we not use the absolute value of the visibility. Then if you look in the literature, some authors use a praxis factor of 3, the next of 10, the next of 20, and a little bit stupid, then we need a method that is valid for every situation, and we cannot adapt the praxis factor for different situations. And that is the reason that we say we count only the invisible objects on every position. And that, and then another point is that we have used not only the contrast of this object against the background of this object, then normally we are in a dynamic situation. That means we move on this road, and first we see this background against this object, and if we come closer, then this this surrounding is changing. That means we calculated every contrast for this object with every background luminance distribution. And so we counter all visible positions for every object, and at the end you get such a diagram. That means, for instance, for object with a reflection degree 0.4, then you have a probability of hidden objects of roughly 40%. Yeah, in this area, and for the oncoming lane, and here you can see for the own lane, and for the own lane you can see all objects till 0.5 as reflection degree, and for very bright objects, for instance 0.8, in 10% of the cases you cannot see this object. And with this method you can compare different lighting installation, different lighting designs, to decide what lighting design gives a better visibility comparable with another lighting design. So, and now I will present the results of this. Here are the four different lighting situations with the four lighting different lighting distributions. And the light levels are very low. Yeah, it's not comparable with M1 class or so, where we have one candela per square meter or more. Yeah, that especially if we speak about low lighting levels. And in this case, you see that if you would use the luminance as counter for quality, we would say, okay, that's much brighter than the other ones with 0.3. That's the best one, followed by Zine 1, followed by Zine 2, and followed by Zine 3. But the experiment gives another ranking. The experiment shows that the counter beam has the best visibility on position 1, followed by the relative bright solutions, followed by symmetric with the 0.15 candela per square meter, and that's the last one. If that brings us that the luminance concept is not good enough to predict the right sequence of the visibility of a street. Let's have a look to the small target visibility. That's used this concept from the American colleagues in Canada and the US. And they use only the 50% reflection degree. And if you look here, for position 3 and 4, that's fine. Also, that's if you have the small target visibility, 4 and 3, that's fine, what we found in the experiment. But it changed for the position, for the lighting scene 3 and 2. Yeah, that's changing. And so, and the reason is that if you have different reflection degree, it's not enough to use the 50% reflection degree, like for the small target visibility concept. It comes from the tunnel, and in the tunnel it is probably enough to check only the 50% reflection degree, but for the roads it's not. The best fit we received with the uncertainty of vision, here you can see the ranking, and this is the values for the uncertainty of vision, and so you can find that's place 1, place 2, place 3, followed by place 4. And the last point is the uncertainty of vision is adjustable with the luminance intensity curve. We can create different visibilities through the right luminance intensity curve. My last solution is marking light. Here, another PhD candidate developed a system with a thermal camera with far infrared, and with in the first stage, in the first step with the moving head, the next step is to use a LED array to lit the people here in this example. And now I can change. So you can see we lit the pedestrian or the cyclist, and normally everybody of us has the experience that if it's raining, you cannot see pedestrians between cars or cyclists. And normally we have a small shock, more or less, if we come very close to this and realize that we have a cyclist or pedestrian in 5 or 6 or 10 meters in front of us. And this technical solution gives us the possibility to see this object 200 or 200 meters before as a situation where we have to react. So let us go to the summary. We learned that road safety should guarantee the riskless and concurrent usage of traffic areas by different traffic participants. We learned that the riskless usage means that we have to have good conditions for visual perception. Visual perceptions, we need good lighting conditions, and for a good road safety, we can reduce the maximum speed. We can increase our light levels. We can use adaptive concept that we use only the light when it's really necessary. In the situations we have, or we can use the visibility concepts, and at the end I have shown the marking light. Thank you for listening.